determining to a very fine degree the difference between the two rates, then you can apportion. But again, you need to be able to show your apportionment figure quite clearly, because if we come out and do a visit at some point in the future, those are the sorts of things we're going to look at, because of course a crossover in a VAT rate is going to be a risk area, isn't it, from our point of view. So it's going to be something that we might check on. So would I be right in assuming then that most of you in the room, if you're not retailers, in which case you're cash businesses anyway for the most part, that you're on a cash accounting scheme with the ATP. So you're only giving us VAT when you've been paid by your customer. Would that be the case for most people for invoicing? So I hope you don't mind singling you out. So would you be accounting for VAT when you should be invoicing?
Yeah.
So I find, in my experience with talking to small businesses, most small businesses use the cash accounting scheme because, of course, you issue your invoice, VAT's on it, but you don't have to give us the VAT until you've been paid. So, of course, it's clearly a good scheme for small businesses. But for some businesses, it may not suit them. So they still prefer to account for the VAT on the issue of the VAT invoice. But if you're on cash accounting, again, you clearly just need to identify any supplies that happened for which you're receiving payment after that date. So it may well be in the same way that the deposits work, it's that you've received a payment, but you've actually supplied the service, or whatever it happens to be, after that date. So it's a sort of switching of the thing. So even if you only receive the payment after the date, but the provision was made before that date, you still only have to account for that at 79%. If you're on annual accounting and you're making instalments, so that works much like a budget scheme, you may be keeping monthly payments through the year, your payments won't be affected this time. And if you're on the flat rate scheme, anybody on the flat rate scheme? Yeah, so the flat rate percentages will be amended and will come into force on and after January. Payments on account scheme, this is for larger businesses who have a VAT liability of 2 million payments, actual VAT or more. That's a special scheme for this type of business. And what they do is they have to give us a little bit every month. So normally you would put that return in and it's once a quarter and that's when you pay. They will actually have to give us a payment at the end of each month and then the sort of balancing payment at the end of the quarter. So that's a slightly different scheme and the rates will be revised again in line with the entry of that is 2 million, the VAT liability, and the exit is 1.6 million. So if it falls below the 2 million, we'll leave the scheme. But those will be amended, and again, if it does affect any of you, then you need to know that that's going to change. So cross-border changes. These changes actually came in on the 1st of January this year. And I'm finding even now, all these months on, that people are still having a degree of concern and confusion in some cases. And as Pam said, we're very happy to take questions from you. But I said this to everybody, and I said, if you need any further help, I'm sitting outside there in the networking area. And I ended up with a queue about 15 long. And guess what? Most of the questions were about these changes. And a lot of people just needed a bit of clarification. I'm doing this, is that right? So a bit of reassurance, I think, in some ways. And some of the questions, well, like that. So I had to take email addresses and I will look it up when I get back to the office. Because I actually don't have that information around in my head, may surprise you to know. And I was thinking about asking for Sage to set up a ticket machine for the queue that I made here today. To get to the experience. So, who's it affecting then? So if you supply services to overseas businesses and you receive services from overseas businesses, if you supply goods to any other EC member state, and businesses that want to reclaim VAT when they're out on their travels. So a lot of people may go to Europe for their business, incur costs, petrol, we're talking about here is you, you're VAT registered in the UK, and your customer is VAT registered in another member state. That's the business to business bit. That's what we mean when we say business to business. And before these changes, it would normally be, and this is for services by the way, the supplier of the service, with few exceptions, was the person who accounted for the VAT. So you put it on your normal UK VAT return, and that would be the end of it. And that's completely been turned on its head, and now for services, it is the customer who accounts for the VAT. So a real fundamental change there to the system, and understandably, could cause some confusion. And the reverse charge mechanism that's referred to on there is really causing some confusion because people are just not grasping how reverse charges work. I'll explain a bit more about that. And then the business to non-business customer, by that we mean somebody who's not registered for VAT in their EC member state. So that could be, as happens a lot, you're making a sale over the internet to Joe Public in France or Italy or wherever it happens to be. And so they can't account for the VAT using reverse charges because they're not registered for VAT. So you will have to account for the VAT on your UK VAT. So effectively what you're doing is you're treating it as a domestic sale, as a UK. So the VAT's got to go somewhere. In that case, because the customer can't account for the VAT, because they're not VAT registered, you have to account for it on their behalf. Sounds complicated, it isn't. Well, it's easier for me to say, isn't it? So the general rule then, and as with anything to do with taxes, you have a general rule and then you have all the exceptions. So the general rule, the place of supply of services is, and other than those covered by the special rules, is the place of supply of your services is where your customer belongs for the purpose of receiving your supply. So that's the bit where I would say you're registered in the UK, your customer's registered in Germany or wherever. So things like intermediary services, transport of goods, ancillary transport services, valuation of work on goods, etc. And there is a list that's readily available, are the things that are included in this rule, in the basic rule. And then we've got a fairly long list of exceptions. I'll just give you a few. So the general rule excludes things like immovable property, which could be land, passenger transport, short-term hire of means of transport, services related to cultural, artistic, sporting, scientific, educational, entertainment, or similar, and so this goes on. But the lists are readily available on our website. So of course, again, as with anything to do with that, we can only give you a very, very short, sharp taster today, but really flagging up issues that may affect you. So go on the website and that much more detailed information is there. And if you want to know where it is, it's in cross-border changes. There's a banner on the VAT homepage on the right-hand side. Click on that and it'll take you straight through to the legislation and other information that you may need. So business to customer, as I say, we're talking about you, VAT registered UK customer, not VAT registered for whatever reason. So they might be a private individual, a charity, a government department, or another body that doesn't have any actual business activities. As you probably already know, but in a lot of the European countries, if you're in trade or commerce of any sort, you're registered for VAT. The threshold is actually very low or nil. We in the UK